So there's something in the news that's blown up in the news, and my guess is, certainly this is a really interesting time to be teaching a class on race and ethnicity in the United States, because there's so much happening in these months, days and months. But some of you are aware of the controversy involving this gentleman and John Lewis. John Lewis is a congressional representative from Georgia, and he was on one of the talk shows, and he said, basically, I don't see Donald Trump as a legitimate president, and I think the Russians somehow participated in this election to help him get elected. Now, when you make a statement about a person who's been elected president and say, I don't think he's a legitimate president, legitimate candidate, those are fighting words. That's really serious. You've like taken the fire and you've turned it way up. So when he makes that statement, it's a big, big statement. So the response, and whenever anybody makes that statement, when any of us in here make a statement that's really hardcore like that, you're gonna get a response back. And so the response was pretty swift and quick from Donald Trump. Congressman John Lewis should spend more time on fixing and helping his district, which is in horrible shape, horrible shape, horrible shape, falling apart. And not to mention crime infested, rather than falsely complaining about the election results. All talk, 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 no action or results, sad, okay? Now what got people, truthfully, if you want my personal opinion on it, that's the kind of response I would expect from a very strong statement from Lewis. And certainly coming from Donald Trump, that's actually a mild response from Donald Trump. But it's the kind of response, if you start up here, you're going to get a response up here. And so he got that response. And what people are really unsettled about is this idea, all talk, talk, talk. That's what really got people, because people are calling, are referring to John Lewis as a national hero. Now, I'm not really sure what a hero is, and I'm very careful about using that word hero and throwing it around very quickly, but you get up to everybody to decide whether you want to call John Lewis a hero. I wouldn't call him a hero if you have no idea what his background is and what he's done. So those of you who have referred, who are familiar with this controversy and have referred to him as a hero because you heard somebody else say it and you don't know what he's done, I would strongly suggest that you don't use a word like that till you actually find out for yourself. Okay? Well, the heat really got turned up. Next slide. This guy is some kind of state commissioner or county commissioner or something, and he says John Lewis is a racist pig. He's one of many people who have now taken it to another level. A racist pig. This guy's white, by the way. He's from the South, too. There ain't one political pundit that didn't say on November 9th that this would be demon rats. Demon rats. I like that. It's the first time I've heard that. Demon rats. Exact response to Trump winning. Like I heard Rush, I believe, say, demon rats do not live in reality. They believe polls were right and the real votes were wrong. What a bunch of idiots. So now there are a number of other people who have really ramped this up and calling John Lewis all sorts of things, including a racist pig. Now, racist pig isn't in itself racist. If he called him a racist monkey, that would be racist, because apes and monkeys were used to caricature black people historically, people of African ancestry, and the caricature then becomes a racist statement. So when you refer to someone of African ancestry as a monkey or an ape, that's a real move down the world of racism. Pig is not. Now, if he was referring to a police officer, then people would have a real issue with that, because of 1984, people associating police with pigs, and then that's a different story, right? But racist pig isn't itself a problem, but ramping it up is. And so John Lewis comes out of the gate hardcore, and this is the response. Now, what I want to say is the following. So that's me being just the sociologist. Wow, watch what happens when the rhetoric gets turned up. And you, you, You jam up the rhetoric and you get a response. And here, if I get rhetorical, if I start making really hardcore comments about people, issues, policies, any number of things, people are going to respond back in a hardcore way. And I see it on Twitter. You know, when I say certain things, it comes back on Twitter. Okay? By the way, yeah. What I want to say is because we are in MLK week, not just day, week, it is a time to think about the civil rights movement and celebrate the civil rights movement. It's not just about MLK, Martin Luther King, it's about the whole movement. And now we're at a different place with this. I just want to say something about it because I have a feeling, and I think I'm probably right, that most of you really don't understand what the civil rights movement was all about. So I want to show you some things, and ultimately I want to talk a little bit, say a few things about John Lewis. Especially for the people who, and many of you in here who are hearing people are critiquing Lewis, before you critique, before you say like, oh yeah, this guy is racist, he's making things worse, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, whatever that might be, I think you really need to understand where he's coming from and why so many people are really incensed. So let me I'm just going to give you a very tiny slice of life. You know, when slavery ended, meaning it became illegal, right? It didn't stop slavery. Slavery stopped at the end of the Civil War. Slavery as we think about slavery, but slavery as a system, as social relationships, didn't really stop. Meaning that there are many level-headed commentators and students of slavery that argue, and of the United States, that argue that conditions for black Americans after slavery actually got worse, not better. And the only way to understand that, of course, is to study it yourself. What happened in post-slavery period after 1865? But some of the components of slavery that we talk about, segregation, continued all the way up into the 60s. Especially with regard to the issue, I mean, there are many, many things, but I'm just going to look at one, school segregation. That white schools in black and brown schools. And it didn't matter if you were a black or brown student living right next to a white school, you went to another school. Separate drinking fountains. Understand what it would mean to have at a place like Penn State University, separate drinking fountains. And over one, colored, and the other, white. Separate bathrooms. In a class like this, separate seating areas. Where in one area would be all the dark-skinned people, or even light-skinned people who were considered black, and then all the white people somewhere else. Hardcore. We don't really most of us don't understand that, or don't think about the fact that this was not that long ago. So in Little Rock in 1957, they decide we're going to desegregate the schools. We're going to have to, because the United States passed laws that said we're going to now desegregate. And the states, one by one, are going to have to abide by these laws. Fundamental, unbelievable segregation. So you got it, right? You understand? Dudes, look, if you can force black kids and brown kids to go to separate schools, you can understand that they probably weren't treated, their parents probably were not treated very well in the workplace. You get that, right? If you can go as far as having separate drinking fountains, you can assume that opportunities in the workplace, or when you go to a bank to get a loan, or whatever you want to do, are not very equal. But we'll come back to that later in the semester. So these were 9 kids. They started with 10, but one dropped out pretty quickly. These were 9 kids who were picked out to desegregate Little Rock Central High School. It's a big, massive high school. I was there a few years ago. Big, massive high school. And they picked them because of their grades, because of who they were, because of their way of carrying themselves, really strong personality, super smart, ability to really get along very well with white people and understand the issues and not be bitter and not be angry. And most importantly, the ability to take abuse. So they pick these folks out, right? And you think, okay, they're going to desegregate. Next slide. So Little Rock, and in fact, people coming from all over the state show up in droves. Droves. Thousands of people. It's like, no way. The Negroes are not going to enter into our high school. In droves, with guns, with anything they needed to stop this from happening. 10 young 15 and 16 year olds from integrating. Okay? Next slide. Here on one of the very first day, right? The very first day. So this is one of the students. And this student right here is Elizabeth Eckford. Now look at that. Look at like this woman back here. And the mobs, these are mobs following her. She had to leave the school because it was unsafe, because the governor had pulled back all the police and said, listen, first off, he put the local police in place to say, you will stop all the black kids from the State National Guard. You will stop all the black kids from entering the school. That's your first job. So don't even let them enter. That's how hardcore the governor was. And then they pulled everybody back. So there was no protection. So see these guys back here? Nothing. They're not going to do anything. These mobs are following her and really afraid for her life. They were able to shuffle her into a car and get her out of there. And so all the 10 kids left. So the president of the United States calls out the National Guard and says, this is big, you all, the National Guard. The army in the United States said, y'all going to Little Rock, we're going to desegregate the high schools in Little Rock. This is how deep racism is entrenched. Deeply it's entrenched. Next slide. So here they are, coming in. Guns, anything you need, because we're going to have a civil war on our hands again. So here, next slide. So look, everywhere the students went, they had guards. All year long, guards. A student never went anywhere without guards. Even going to the bathroom, the guard stood right outside to wait to see if anything would happen. So imagine this. This is hardcore. This is what the civil rights movement was about, you all. Just trying to go to school. Can we go to this school or this school? Can I not go as a black student? Can I not go to the school that's right next to my house? No, you got to go to that one over there. Why not? Because that's for white people. Look, it's just very simple things. Can we not have to drink at a separate drinking fountain? Can we not have to this? Can we not have to that? Forget about even, can I even get a job? Next slide. Look at this. So here are these guys. I mean, white people came out, y'all, right? They were ready for war. And so here are the soldiers. Look at the bayonets, man. Like, no. We will get you away from these students. This is big. Watch footage on it. Just jump on YouTube on your own and just watch some of the footage. Okay? So who is John Lewis? John Lewis is one of the people who are on the front lines of protesting all of this segregation, because it was nonviolent. You understand, nonviolent. Can you go back a few? Can you go back some? Right, one more. Here. You know who the civil rights movement was? You know what MLK said? MLK said that when we protest to go to a school or a church or a road, or we want to protest to ride a bus, we're going to walk down through crowds of people like this, and we're going to be nonviolent. Whatever they do to us, we're still going to be nonviolent. And you couldn't be part of the movement if you weren't nonviolent. And that meant that these people, who were clearly just racist, they're going to beat you up. Police are going to sick the dogs after you, the fire hoses, whatever it is. But you're going to take it. Because if you fight back, they win. That's the strategy. Do you know, come on, white people. white people, just for a hot minute, just for a hot minute, just imagine. Here, go ahead, go ahead. I'm going to come back to white people. Okay, here we go. There's John Lewis. They were going to walk, they walked over this bridge. This was a big march. And you know where the police were on the other side? Like this. You ready? With their batons. And as soon as they walked over the bridge, they beat the shit out of them. And you know what? They're walking over the bridge knowing they're going to get beat up. They're going to get beat up by the police, by the racist police, by the police who are trying to hold in place a system of deeply entrenched racism that grew out of slavery and wasn't much different than slavery. They're going to get beat up. White people, for a second. And just, I'm going to just focus on white people. Can you just, how would you do, y'all? How you gonna? How would you do when you watched your mother getting beat up by, a, let's say, a black police officer? How are you going to do? You going to stand up and defend her? No, you're not. You're going to let your mother get beat up. You know why? Because if you stand up and defend her, the whole movement shuts down. This is the power of the civil rights movement. This is the power of MLK. I saw somebody tweeted, some Penn State student, I think, tweeted yesterday or something like, well, you know, thank God MLK died because I got to have a whole day of partying or something like that. You know what I mean? Clearly not understanding. Here's Lewis. Go ahead. Next one. There's Lewis right there. Got that? Coming down on his head. Now understand when Donald Trump says, all talk, 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 where's the action? This is the, what a lot of people understand about John Lewis. Even all talk, talk, talk. Shit. Hey, somebody, does somebody want to come down here and let me beat him in the head with a baton? And then we'll talk about talk, talk, talk? Next slide. There's John Lewis. So this stuff is complex. And so when I hear people talking about, you know, like just throwing stuff out there, that, you know, the whole Donald Trump thing, I get the response. But when I hear other people just sort of jumping on the bandwagon and like calling this guy a racist pig, dude, chill out, cowboy, chill out, relax. Different world. So you can critique Lewis, and he's a Democrat. So if I lived in his district, I'm reasonably certain I wouldn't vote for him. And I would not have voted for him. Because I'm not a Democrat. But come on, does it give him a right to say what he said about Donald Trump? Nah, man, it doesn't give him a right. Can I understand it? Yeah, I can understand it. Would I expect a really strong response? Yeah, I would expect a really strong response. But those of you giving a really strong response, chill out a little bit, man. Unless you really know what's going on and what this guy's going through. Come on. This is about. So it's trying to see these multiple angles and multiple perspectives. You can be in two places at once. You can be in two places at once. You can think this, and you can think this. That's a good thing. Complex thinking is a really, really good thing. And that's the purpose of this class. That we can critique Lewis, maybe for making a statement like that, or maybe for some of the policies that he supports in his district or whatever, right? Some of the ways he casts his vote, which I would venture to guess the vast majority of people don't know anything about. And we could critique the people who are critiquing him. Come on. Cool? And my guess would be that Donald Trump and the guy that called him a racist pig really don't know much about the civil rights movement. What was Donald Trump doing during the civil rights movement? Oh, I got it. No, wasn't he getting deferments so he didn't have to go to Vietnam? No, that wasn't quite yet. Well, I guess it was the beginning of the civil rights movement. Cool? We good? All right, man. Oh, wait. I got one more. Let me show you a couple more photos. Look at that guy's pulling his tooth out. Here, this, look at blood, look at the blood all over him. Look at blood all over him. He's in there, he's probably got his tooth knocked out. All talk, talk, talk. All talk, talk, talk. So Trump people, you do have a responsibility. You can support Donald Trump. It's fine. It's great. But you do have a responsibility to also understand what the other issues are. Just like the anti-Trump people, you can be anti-Trump, but you do have a responsibility to understand what some of the other issues are. One final thing. Look at these guys here. Southern whites are the Negroes' best friends, but no integration. I guess John Lewis just didn't realize that, huh? MLK. I guess if these guys would have just been more clear, then the whole civil rights movement could have just gone away. Because I'm thinking that clearly white men had the best interests of Negroes in mind when they beat the shit out of them coming over the bridge or protesting a segregated lunch counter or protesting the fact that their children couldn't go to the same schools as white kids or whatever the case.
Absolutely still does exist, and so does racism. So even if we look at all of these pictures right now from back in the day, it still happens and it still exists. So when you have somebody like Trump to become president who's saying this Lewis guy is all talk and did nothing, isn't that extremely alarming for this entire country? To have somebody like that about to be a leader. Meanwhile, much of his supporters don't want to go out of their way to be educated. They don't want to go out of the way to watch 13th. Like, where does the progress actually begin?
Well, I don't know. I can't say anything about Trump supporters because I don't know that they don't want to go out of their way. I would guess if I had to weigh it, I'd say most of them really don't. But most of the other supporters, that most Americans don't go out of their way. And I don't know that it's any more alarming than if I were, and I will as the semester goes on, talk about some of the policies of Barack Obama that would have been pursued by Hillary Clinton. Those are equally as alarming to me. Maybe not to Americans per se, but definitely what's going on overseas. I mean, my gosh. So I would say that that's equally as alarming, to use that word. So you asked in the end, like, where's the hope or where's the progress? Well, first off, the progress is really everywhere, right? The progress is the fact that we can have an election like this and not have a civil war. That's pretty big. And the progress that even in spite of everything, we're still not seeing very much violence at all. And that's really, really big. And mostly it's just words. It could turn into more, but I think that's pretty big progress. And there's a lot of progress. Like, I hear a lot of, especially black people, talk about, well, nothing has changed. Ah, shit, man. Come on. Don't ever say nothing has changed. You know what I mean? A lot has changed. If you say nothing has changed, you've never watched any of the footage from Jim Crow era United States. Like, you can't say nothing has changed. A lot has changed. And so, you know, many things. And I think that a lot of times people just throw stuff out there. Like John Lewis just very quickly said, Donald Trump's not a legitimate candidate. You know, like, I see things sometimes I'm just off the cuff. I'm not really thinking straight, and I say it, and later I think, I didn't really mean that. I'm much more careful now because the cameras are running, and I'm trying to be, you know, really thoughtful because I get too much hate when I'm not thoughtful. But we can. So a lot of times people will say just things off the cuff, like, oh, we haven't seen any progress anywhere. It's like, look, you don't really mean that. Come on, you don't mean that. You can't say that, and you don't mean it. Like, Trump's the worst thing that ever happened, or Barack Obama was the best president ever. It's like, come on. Yeah. Bro. Who chose the Little Rock Nine? Yeah, I think it was the local, oh man. I should know.
Chose like really intelligent people that got along with.
Wait, hang on. Just use that if you could.
You said that they chose like really intelligent people who got along with white people really well. Do you think it would have went completely south if they have chosen people who were like from lower socioeconomic places, who were less intelligent,
who were more violent or more prone to respond?
Yeah.
So for example, there's one of the girls, her name was Minnie Jean. This guy was just hounding her at lunch. I mean, there was a story. It's really some amazing footage of this stuff. And this white kid was just hounding her every day, just calling her, dropping the M-bomb. Man, it was just N-bomb, one after another, boom, 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 nigga, 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 every day, okay? You can't, and these guys, they talk about it, they just can't even believe it, right? And this, she finally, it's just, she couldn't take it, she'd had a hard day, and she's got her lunch, her tray, and she's standing at the lunch counter, and this kid's just hammering away at her. After about 4 months of taking this, and she finally turns around with her tray, and she dumps it on his head. And everybody cheered. All of the cooks working at the school, they were all black. They all cheered. But that was her last day in school. They had to kick her out. Why'd she get kicked out? Why didn't the kid get kicked out? Because that's the nature of it. You don't win through violence. The civil rights movement, it succeeded because of the nonviolence. And so this is the key. And so, yeah, so they chose people with the right temperament.
Do you think it helped with stereotypes at all that these kids were very intelligent and that they were tempered well?
Or not for most people, man. The hate was, the people who were already open, and the hate was really deep, man. Hate was deep, y'all. Dude, these people in the South were calling for another civil war, man. Yeah. Yeah. Does that answer it?
Yeah,
good questions. I like that. Anybody else have anything they want to add or say? Or brother at the top, man. Hang on 1 second. I'll get up there. Excuse me, my man.
Did they, when they sent the 10 to the white school, did they send any black guys or black students to...
White students
to black schools?
They did not. Not in the first wave of integration. Later they did. Like my school, for example, when I was in fifth grade, we had black students come to our school, and then we had white students go to other schools. But they didn't in the first wave.
How do you think that would have, like...
Well, it wouldn't have happened. Dude, listen, man. They closed the school down. You know, like in, was it Nashville, Raleigh, somewhere. One city closed the schools for an entire year. The schools, instead of integrating, y'all, this is white supremacy, y'all, right? You understand? Instead of integrating, an entire school system was closed down for a year. They said, no, nope, instead of letting our kids go, we're just going to close it down. A number of school systems, I'm sure, but I know of one. I just can't remember the city, right? I used to show a video in this class. That's how intense the racism was. Imagine that. Imagine the Philadelphia, those of you who are from Philly, the whole Philadelphia school system closing down instead of. Like, so that's what we're at. So white people just wouldn't have gone to school.
Yeah, that's nuts.
Yeah. Yeah, it's hardcore. Yes, ma'am. Hey, by the way, what's your name, bro?
Nick.
What's your name?
Katie Rose.
Katie.
So just something kind of interesting. I'm from Nevada, and Congressman John Lewis actually went to Nevada in 2014 for a book signing while he was in Congress. And that's very unusual. And so, like, I don't support Donald Trump at all, but his tweet isn't necessarily completely wrong. Because
ooh, Donald Trump's tweet?
Yeah. About John Lewis.
Because?
Because while he was in Congress, when he's supposed to be, you know, serving his constituents in Georgia, he traveled to Nevada to do a book signing.
Okay, hang on. Let me help you with that. Congressional representatives and senators spend a relatively small amount of time in Washington.
Yeah,
or even
no, I
in
understand
their districts,
that.
Or even in their districts, y'all. Like, yeah. They're moving all the time.
Yeah,
so,
and okay. A book signing, I mean, that's great. Like, the book was, you know, about the civil rights movement, mm-hmm. And that's, you know, very important.
Yeah.
But I just found it kind of interesting what he was doing.
Okay, all right. But let me be clear. Dude, hang on. First off, very cool. thanks. For that's it shows your thinking, like, critically and so on, uh-huh. And that's how I would say, because I'm always like, why aren't these people in Washington? Why aren't they doing something? However, it's not any different than the vast majority of people who are going on junkets. They're going here, they're going to trips, they're going, you know, all over the place. So okay. If you really study senators and congressional reps and so on, these folks spend too little time working, in my humble opinion. So that's not outside the realm of.
Okay.
Yeah. But although yes. I like that you raised
Sam to your left.
Yes. As a general rule, I'm completely with you. I think it shouldn't happen at all. Yes, ma'am.
So you said about how, like, nowadays racism is primarily words and it's less acts of violence.
No, I didn't say that. I mean, that may have been what it sounded like I said. It may have actually been kind of what I said, but it really wasn't. Well, go ahead. Just finish okay. your thing.
My question wasn't really about that anyways. But
right.
So like in today's society where there are a lot of people that are making these off-the-cuff comments, and especially in a day where you can publish a tweet or a Facebook post and have it, you're a published author on the internet.
Yeah.
Would you agree if I said that social media kind of propels racism, like putting a screen in front of someone's face, how they don't see the impact of their words, and how do we combat it?
Okay, look, it propels all sorts of negativity, racism being one of them, sexism, I mean, there are all sorts of classism, hate, it propels it because it makes it a lot easier. For example, Katie, right? Katie's gonna get a lot of hate from that. And some of you probably did, and I probably should call some of you out too, because I like the statement, but you're going to get responses on Twitter, going to be like, rah, 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 right? And I'm like, oh, don't do that, because it's a good point, but most of us don't know what's going on. Like, you just don't, like, what's your name?
Katie. No, just Kate.
So Kate here just doesn't know what she doesn't know. Bro, what's your name? What is it?
Michael.
Michael just doesn't know what he doesn't know. So I can think I know something about this, but I don't know anything about that. Like me, I don't know anything about most things. So be careful. So I think it propels a lot of that. It's too easy. Hang on, though. What I said, the issue is that it's not that we don't see violence. It's we see surprisingly little violence, given the past. Surprisingly little. And you can say, yeah, but there's so much more violence today. You really gotta study it. You gotta look at it. And it's hard when you're 18 or 20, but, you know, yeah. So I want to be clear about that so I don't get hate. Anybody else have a question? Or?
Yo, wait. Yeah. Who is Yannick Cambry?
Who?
Yannick Cambry. Right, you in here because you just tweeted. Where are you at? Don't be scared.
What'd Yannick
say? I'll put your tweet up on the screen.
What'd Yannick say?
Sprinkle your opinion.
Hey, what?
He says, I want to sprinkle my opinion in Social 19, but I'm low-key scared of the black backlash, and
I don't want him
to be scared.
Yo, don't
be scared. It's an open dialogue.
Yo, where you at? I got your back, dog.
Where you at, though? Stand up.
All right, man.
Yes! Woo! Welcome to Social 19.
Dude, keep pass that back. Wait, you're afraid of black backlash? No, wait, go ahead.
Backlash.
Yeah.
I actually don't have a thing to say right now, but, you know, when it comes, I might, you know, sprinkle my opinion, like I said.
Okay, all right, dude. Okay, good. Make sure you do. Seriously. No, really do, because it's really important. Look, it's not that we don't want really, really, really extreme positions, but we want people to take positions. You know what I mean? I think it's really important. Okay, well, I'll give you something to take positions on here. You ready? Let's do it. Let's do an activity. Dude, what's your name, Yannick?
Yeah.
Is it, yeah? All right. All right, man. I need two volunteers. And I need one person who is just critical of everything, man. You're a skeptic. You're, you're skeptical of everything. No matter what people say, you're like, ah, nah, whatever, right? Seriously? Yeah, you're on? I don't mean it's critical of everything, including like John Lewis and...
Oh, see.
No, you gotta be like, no, you gotta come at it from all angles, right? So are you liberal and... No, no, but it could be you. Okay, hang on. Maybe it might be you. Who? Somebody else who's really critical of it. Bro, dude with the beard. You just seem like you are. You know what I mean? All right. All right. A white guy with a... Okay, dude, here, stand up real fast. And then I need somebody who's really... and then I need somebody who's really into women's issues, in particular issues related to sexual assault. Preferably a female, but doesn't have to be a female. Sexual assault issues? Seriously? Hardcore? All right, come on. Two white guys.
Yes.
All right. Wait. Where is he? That was good enough. Okay. All right, bro. So what's your name?
My name is Vincent.
Vincent?
Yeah.
And you're the skeptic.
Yeah, that's pretty accurate.
You're all right, and bro, what's your name?
Shane.
Shane?
Yep.
And you are, and so what makes you a skeptic, by the way?
I don't know. I feel like so many people say different things, and a lot of times, you know, they're coming from different perspectives. And to properly analyze everything, you have to take those things into account. And like you've talked about it with the Jenna Bush thing, and now with this Trump and John Lewis, where both of them have aspects that they're saying that are correct, that have validity, and both of them are just being volatile or are coming from a sense of a misunderstanding about each other's positions and where they're coming from.
Yep.
And so
okay.
I think just in general, especially when it comes to politics and media, I feel like it's a requirement to be skeptical about everything you read and see.
So with the John Lewis piece, though,
I can understand why he's upset, but like going on it specifically right now, like I don't think that it's correct to assume that Trump has no idea about the civil rights movement.
Yeah.
I'm sure he hasn't, you know, he hasn't read a dozen books on it. He hasn't taken specific classes on it. But I think it's naive to consider someone who, I mean, he's wealthy, he's from New York, he's well educated. He has to have some semblance of idea of the civil rights movement. I'm sure he knows who John Lewis is. He's been in Congress forever.
Yeah.
And I think a lot of people jump to conclusion thinking that Trump had no idea who John Lewis is,
yeah.
No idea what he did.
Yeah, exactly.
I don't want to make an assumption on what Trump is actually saying, but his all talk, I think you can remove that, what he's saying. He's not necessarily saying all talk when it comes to civil rights. In my head, I'm guessing, I'm not going to assume though, that he's referring specifically to his political experience in Congress.
Yeah.
And I mean, he's from Atlanta. I don't know if anyone's from Atlanta, I'm sorry, but like, and I'm from Philadelphia. A lot of these major metropolitan cities, they do have serious crime issues, which Trump acknowledges.
Yeah.
And you can argue whether or not, depending on your politics, whether John Lewis has done his part in alleviating that, whether he could do more.
Yeah, okay. So dude, all right, that's fair. Dude, that's a really nice response, y'all, right?
Thanks.
Have you found yourself with me, things that I've said, you're like, I don't know about this guy?
Yeah, definitely.
Good. All right. Make sure. Bro, what makes you really involved or interested in gender issues, particularly sexual assault, particularly with respect to women?
Well, I'm taking a lot of I'm a criminology major, so I've taken a lot of classes on it. Currently taking one basically for domestic and sexual violence with Karen Bloom. Awesome class, recommend it.
I recommend it also.
I've taken a bunch of her classes, and it's women's studies, like, and a lot of law and society. And I feel like there are a lot of issues because, like, in society we don't really talk about it because it's really frowned upon, not really brought up a lot. And I personally, that's what I want to go and do in my career in criminology. I want to join the FBI or, State Department, and hopefully end human trafficking at one point in my life. So,
yeah. All right.
That's what we're going to do.
All right, cool. All right, man. So here's what I want to do. Is there one more chair I could have? Can you have a seat, bro? And bro, you can have a seat also. here. No, go ahead. Bro, I need to sit there. I want you to be able to see this. Okay, so here's where we're at. One of the things related to this class that I think is really important are data. You know, people say, okay, statistics lie and so on and so forth. It's like, no, look, you have data. Your data can be valid, they can be reliable, they can be more or less valid, they can be more or less reliable. Valid meaning that they're actually measuring what you say they're measuring. And reliable meaning that if you keep studying the same thing over time and measuring the same thing over time, you're going to get the same results, okay? Data are data, though. And most data are all data. You got to look and see where they come from. So for me, it's really important that y'all understand in this class, I'm really careful about data, and I'm particularly careful about data because I've been called out by students too many times, even in the middle of class, like on Twitter, like my data are wrong, or they're misleading, or they're this, or they're that, and I try to be really, really careful, but I'm not always as careful as I could be. So the skeptics, bro, people like you in the class, your job is to really be questioning where the data are from. That said, you can't just throw out all data because sometimes data are just data. They're just numbers. But you interpret them in certain ways. And so really part of academia that should be true across the board is for people like me who are studying things and using data, I would get people from different perspectives. So if we're going to look at sexual assault, which is what we're going to look at right now, I would want somebody like you, and certainly I would want a woman as well, right? And I want somebody like you who's going to sit back and say, yeah, but what about this or what about that? Now, it's harder when you get into the world of race or gender or sexual assault in particular for anybody to question it at all. And certainly you as a man, are you straight?
Close enough.
Okay, so certainly you as a man who's close enough to being straight, it's like you don't have a very long leash or rope or whatever that you can like not get pulled back, all right? So here, go to the first one. I want to come back to Native Americans that I talked about. And these numbers, the chances of being a victim of a violent crime over a lifetime. Look at the numbers for Native Americans. These are from the Department of Justice, okay? These are reported, by the way. We can't go with unreported. We can only go with reported. And they do a pretty good job of figuring out if they're reported. 124 out of 1,000 for Native Americans. Look at that. Look at the difference. And look at white people. Any thoughts on those data? Right off the top, think about, we talked about Native Americans the other day. These are all Native Americans, men and women. Right? Any thoughts on those?
Well, I mean, this is talked a lot. You know, there's the, especially in race, in questions of race, lots of detractors will throw out the whole black-on-black crime thing.
Yeah.
And then the other side often wisely says, yes, black-on-black crime exists, but it's because black people often live near black people. White people often live near white people. So you're more likely to suffer crime from someone who looks like you, your neighbor or relative or whatever.
So you start going there automatically.
Yeah. So. Okay. I mean this.
Okay. Well, let me go to the next slide. Okay. Right, by the way, you also need to understand when I bring somebody up here and I cut them off because someone tweeted the last guy's like, let them talk. When are you gonna let them talk? It's like, look, if I'm cutting people off, it's because I know where we're going, and I don't want you to like go down this long road and then me have to come back and redo it again. So just give me a little bit of slack. Okay. Next one. So here's the thing, though. The perpetrators. 29%. Of the perpetrators of violent crime against Native Americans, these are just against Native Americans, are other Native Americans. 29%. 60% of the perpetrators of crimes against Native Americans are white. 60%. 10% of the perpetrators of crimes against Native Americans are black and Latino, and then about 1% are other, unidentified, or whatever the case is, okay? Does that say anything to you, by the way?
I mean, it says...
Wait, hang on. Let this guy go.
All good.
No, you're the criminal justice guy.
I mean, it does because, honestly, it kind of speaks to, like, how the colonists were, like, the white against Native Americans. We did, like, we basically are still doing to this day. We're taking their land, beating them up, messing with them.
Okay.
So I kind of agree with the statistics right there, so I'm not going to lie with that.
Okay, dude. Yeah, because are you a liberal, bro?
I'm a hippie.
All right.
What up?
Okay. All right. Bro, Mr. Skeptic.
I mean, the data here...
Yo, hang on. Skeptics, what are you thinking about that? You only got one thing. What's the question you want to ask?
Well, the data here show that my initial thing is not necessarily as applicable here.
Maybe, okay.
Just to play into this whole skeptic role, I'd want to know more about the background of this data because, to my knowledge, a large proportion of Native Americans in the United States, unfortunately, have been kind of secluded and forced onto these reservations. So I'm not totally sure for the average Native American what their exposure is to white people and
Dude,
how
nice
that
question.
Number would arise.
Okay, nice question. Are we got it? Are we cool? Do you get that? That's nice. So this is what I want. I want to generate questions in you. So here, check this out. 58%. You know what that is? That's the percentage of white people who are victims of violent crime by other white people. 58% of white people who are victims of violent crime, that crime is perpetuated by other white people, compared with 29% for Native Americans. 62% of black victims of violent crime have perpetrators who are black, compared with Native Americans. So what is it about all groups who experience violent crime, or exactly what you said, most of the perpetrators of the violent crime look like them, because most people live around other people, and most perpetrators of violent crime are people that you know, even people in your families. What is it about Native Americans that's not true? It's the only group in the United States for whom that's not true. Any thought on that? Bro, Mr. Hippie Liberal, what's your thought? Native Americans, the only group.
Repeat the question one more time.
Well, what do you make of that? It's the only group. The majority of the violent crime they experience are other people, other groups, especially white people, 60%. It's the same as the other groups, only by their own people. Like white people, it's almost like, well, we didn't win. We weren't successful in getting rid of all the Native Americans, so we got to just keep coming back and just hammering away and continuing to commit these violent crimes.
I have a wild guess.
Yeah?
I don't know how people interpret this, but perhaps since Native Americans on these reservations unfortunately are in such terrible conditions due to poverty and everything, I'm thinking maybe where this data could come from, and this is a little out there, is that because of the poor conditions, maybe there is an epidemic of prostitution in Native American communities, and maybe a lot of this data comes from white men who are possibly coming to the reservation, and you know that plays into, I think on the first class, some people were talking about fetishization of different cultures and everything.
All right,
and
cool.
So that would be tying to hit what he wants to study with rape.
Do you have a response to that?
I kind of do, because actually reservations in the law department have their own justice system within them. So technically not all the crimes are reported to the proper authorities, but to the authority of their reservation as well as their tribe. So that's also another issue, because we don't know the actual crime rates per these reservations, so we don't know what's actually going on within
them. Okay. Can we go to the next slide? Rape and sexual assault of indigenous women. Native American women are 2.5 times more likely than other American women to be victims of sexual assault. 2.5 times more likely. That's pretty serious. 2.5 times more likely. 1 in 3 Native American women will be victims of a violent sexual assault. 1 in 3. It's the highest in the United States by far. Right? 86% of all Native American women will have some kind of sexual, unwanted sexual experience in their lives. 86%. In most communities, it's not if this happens, it's when this happens. Right? So now, what's the question? We think, okay, how do we make sense of this? How do we make sense of it, right? Dude, do you have a question?
Do you think the stats on indigenous women being sexually...
Wait, hang on, go ahead.
Do you think the stats on indigenous women being sexually assaulted, do you think that's something that's solely American, or do you think, because I was looking at, like, different stats of indigenous people in other countries, and it seems that like a rule of colonization is to just continuously, like throughout the history of a country, to put the indigenous people down as far as you can.
Yep, and women more so than all other
groups. So do you think that's that stat corresponds to multiple countries?
I would say probably indigenous peoples in other countries. It's very similar, actually. Yep, very similar, and probably very. Yes, ma'am.
Well, I would also say that...
What's your name, by the way?
I'm Reenie.
What is it?
Reenie.
Reenie?
Yeah. I feel like some of these stats could be altered by the fact that a lot of... I mean, from the beginning of American time, there's a lot of mixing between like the Native Americans and white people. And so a lot of white people will have like a small bit of like Native American genes or blood or whatever you want to call it in them. And so at what point do you consider someone a full indigenous woman? Or at what point do you consider like a white person a full white person?
Mm-hmm.
And so in these stats of like, you know, there's only so many Native American people in America and a large majority of Americans are white. So it kind of makes sense that a lot of the crimes would be perpetrated by white people because there's such a statistical majority.
Yeah, but we don't see that with other brown people, right? Like, what's your ancestry?
I'm Indian.
What is it?
Indian.
Indian?
Yes.
Like Asian Indian.
Yes.
So we don't see it with Asian Indians. The majority of the crimes, violent crimes committed and sexual assaults committed against Native Americans, right, are committed by...
But what I'm trying to say is that I feel that...
Whereas here, the majority of the rape and sexual assault that's committed against Native Americans are committed by white men.
But in this study, I feel like you'd need more background on who they're considering Native American and who they're considering white, because you don't know, a lot of
this
Native Americans might just live amongst white people.
Yep.
Or so those crimes would be permitted by... would happen to them by the people around them, which are just white people. So
very good.
Know.
So if, like, Indians, for example, would be more, maybe less likely to be living in an integrated way among white people than, say, like, Asian Indians, less likely than Native American Indians.
Yeah, right? So if they leave their reservation and live with more white people, then it would make sense that if you say so that the crimes are happen to like your neighbors, the family, the people around you, and if those people are white, then that would make sense.
All right, that's cool. Do you have a quick response? Yep.
Are more of these cases happening when white people go into Indian reservations?
It's both.
When they leave?
It's both. And most Native Americans don't live on reservations in the United States, by the way. But it's both. Into reservations and out. Mm-hmm. When Native peoples leave the reservation, and women in particular.
So,
why? Native American women are the only group in the United States that are more likely to be sexually assaulted by somebody other than their race, which is white men.
So are they just the highest just because? Like, why are they so high?
This is the question. They're the poorest group, the least powerful group in the United States. These are the questions. This is why I'm putting this out there. These are the questions, right? This is what I want to get people, I want us to start thinking critically. And we're starting this semester out with some of these examples to keep you asking the questions. I don't know. That's what I want to leave it with that. I don't know.
Hey guys, where's the attendance sheets at? Make sure we're getting those going around quicker because I see that... I mean, this one is
broke. Can you hand that back real fast?
I think that section back there needs to hurry up.
Have you all gotten the attendance sheet? Dude, where's the attendance sheet? Dude, who's holding on the attendance sheet? Can you pass a couple down here? How about the attendance sheet over here? Where's it at? Okay, it's coming. How about over here? Make sure that guy gets the mic. How about over here? Where's it at? So, you need to start one like four rows down and then two rows down. Are we done here? We're almost done. You might want to get these down here and pass them. Take one up there. All right, go ahead, bro.
So where?
Yo, hang on, listen up.
The general vicinity of where these crimes are happening, I think you, like, for instance, you said the Native, the reservations.
Where are they happening?
Yeah, where are they? So I know in at least where a lot of the reservations are like, you know, in the Midwest, which what general population would be around there? Like there tend to be more white people, I think, in that general vicinity.
Okay, listen, here, I don't know the answer to that question. These are good questions, and I'm going to, I don't know. And these are really nice questions. So we're going to, I don't know. Hey, you need to start one like two rows down.
Can I ask a question?
Okay. You're never going to finish this. You need to start one like two rows down. Okay. Get it and find another one. Are you done with the attendance sheet down here? Who has it?
Just stand up.
Okay. All right. Go ahead, bro.
So what do you think this, like, how much does poverty play a role? You brought it up, but like didn't really focus on it. Didn't you say it's like they're significantly poorer? So, and like, maybe the white people they're associating with kind of brings up what he said, like, my bad, may also be significantly poorer. What do you think is like a socioeconomic?
Dude, poverty plays a huge role in all of this, including in violence, including white communities. Listen, this is really important as we move forward. Poverty is fundamental in all forms of violence. So in white communities that are poor, we see much more violence than we do in wealthy white communities. And in wealthier black communities, we see a lot less violence than in poor black communities. In wealthy Latino communities, same thing. It's always back and forth. So poverty is fundamental. The fact that Native Americans are the poorest group in the United States and also experience the most violence and experience the most violence from the outside is something that one might predict. And so the question then becomes is, okay, but we predict it, but what do we mean? Like, what's it all about? That I don't know. That's where we want to go. Like, what do you do? And it somehow, I think, is really deeply entrenched in a certain ideology of, bro, do you have a question?
No, I was going to say, that's what I was going to
No, go ahead, say it. You say it. You have more legitimacy than me because you're black.
I was going to say, my thought on it is I think it's more entrenched in an ideology, like, based on, like, their stature in, like, our society. We kind of, it's almost as if they're looked down on. And it's systematic since we first met them, since we first got here. Like, they've been consistently looking down on, like, their belief systems, everything. They're calling them pagans, wild, and, like, refugees and everything. And I think that that's why they're victimized a lot more than other, like, culture groups.
Yeah, sure. And, like, and same with people of African ancestry, right? Who trace their ancestry to slavery. Mm-hmm. Anyway, gentlemen, thanks. Thanks for your skepticism and thanks for doing what you do, dog. Yeah, I appreciate it.